Welcome once again to Morris County Now Presents. And today we're on location at the home of Alice Paul in Mount Laurel, New Jersey, which is in Burlington County. And we've come here to talk about a very wonderful woman to whom we owe our right to vote. At least we women owe our right to vote. And we're going to be talking all about her today at her home, which is called Paulsdale. And with us we have Amelia Fry, who is the biographer of Alice Paul, and she has been working for quite a number of years on a biography, which hopefully will be out very soon, and it will be the only biography of this very remarkable woman. Amelia Fry is from the University of California at Berkeley, where she is a producer of oral histories, and she's a writer. Also, we have with us Barbara Irvine, who's the president of the Alice Paul Centennial Foundation, which is preserving this home of Alice Paul, and they're both with us today.
Let me give you a little background about who Alice Paul was and what her significance was. Alice Paul was a 20th century feminist women's rights leader who probably more than any other single American did more for gaining full constitutional equality for women than anyone else. First, in working in the final 7 years of the struggle to gain the right to vote for women, where she played a pivotal role in bringing about the passage of the 19th Amendment granting women the right to vote. And then, after suffrage passed in 1920, knowing that even though that gave women political power with the vote, that did not fully correct the fact that women were discriminated against within the laws of the land. And so she set about to correct that by authoring the Equal Rights Amendment, which she saw as the final step that needed to be taken to include women in the Constitution of the United States and to give them full legal equality. So she was a monumental person in this country, but in addition, she was known worldwide for her work on women's rights issues related to women in countries around the world. Alice Paul was really introduced to the notion of women's suffrage by her mother, Tacy Perry Paul, who took Alice Paul to suffrage meetings in Morristown, and so even though Alice didn't work actively at that young age for women's right to vote, she was aware that women did not have the right to vote and that there were people, women, her own mother, who was working to finally have that come to pass.
Alice Paul was a very reticent person. She was a leader whose tactics and the programs and everything that she pulled off were such that somebody said she could make grown men bite their mustache cups. But she herself was very reticent. She stayed behind the scenes. She would set up these elaborate parades and big marches on Congress and so forth. And then when it actually came off, you don't see her in the pictures at all because she was usually off trying to get the next one organized, and because she was shy.
But her first major exposure to the activism related to women's right to vote was at the time that she was studying for her doctorate. She spent some time in England and happened to go to a lecture which was being given by Christabel Pankhurst at the University of Birmingham. And that evening, as Christabel was talking about why British women should have the right to vote, a group of young men became rather unruly and started shouting her off the stage and throwing books and chairs and so on. And of course, Alice Paul was horrified. She had never been in a situation where a person was not allowed to speak or at least give their opinion, and having grown up in the Quaker tradition. So as a result, she, not fully knowing, I think, in some ways, what she might be getting herself in for, she decided that very night that she was going to become part of the British suffrage movement, which she did. And while she was in England, she fought for women's right to vote there, was jailed three times, went on hunger strikes, and basically learned from Sylvia Pankhurst and her two daughters the nonviolent civil disobedience methods that were being used in England as a way of civil protest, which Alice Paul then brought back to this country. And when Alice Paul was waiting in London for her ship to take her back to America, she had a couple of weeks and she joined the, she was already joined, but she began to work actively for the what was called the Women's Social and Political Union, the suffragettes in England. They were the militant group. And I think she must have done a lot of office work for them too. But she went on some of their demonstrations and immediately was arrested, immediately went to jail, and she wound up spending another 6 months there because she hunger struck because they were just beginning to do that, and was force fed. It was brutal. She was kept in solitary confinement in the basement of the prison sometimes. This happened three times, and she was held in jail overnight more times than that. So it was an amazing experience for her, because here she had been this reticent, quiet-spoken person. She had always known women's equality here in Morristown and Mount Lob as a Quaker. They had sex equality for 200 years. And Swarthmore was all for women's suffrage. In other words, she was in a culture where she really hadn't bumped up against people who felt that women weren't equal until she got to New York, and she participated in a little campaign there. But it was later in England as a graduate student there where she went to a lecture that one of the Pankhurst women, Christabel Pankhurst, gave. And the crowd of students, who were mostly male, they were throwing chairs, they brought noisemakers, they wouldn't let her speak. And Christabel was a very strong woman, but that speech she never gave until the next week when the president let her. And Alice Paul came away from that, and she said, right then I knew I wanted to do something whenever I could to help. But she was all set to become a professor, and that lasted until a year and a half into her running the American campaign. And she finally realized that was too big and she never would be a professor and that this was too much. But it had kind of crept up on her, and I think it was all because of this prison experience where she was in solitary confinement, was sitting there day after day for 30 days, listening to the footsteps coming down the hall, going to force feed her again, which was these heavy tubes, not like rubber tubes we have today, put up your nose and down your throat, and it was a horrible experience, and she fought it every time. It left her with no sense of smell and a lot of other injuries, of course. I think that when she came back on the boat, from things that she said and that I've learned, she thought that maybe she could do something in America, but she didn't know what.
At the time Alice Paul entered the suffrage campaign, which in this country really was in December of 1912, the effort to fight for the federal amendment had virtually died. The National American Woman Suffrage Association, that was the major mainstream suffrage organization of the day, had basically committed itself to working for state-by-state referenda, which of course was a very long, excruciating, slow process. Alice Paul was convinced that the only way all the women in the United States would ever have the right to vote was through a constitutional amendment.
Jane Addams, who was a leader in settlement housework and almost America's icon.